Hello and welcome to another edition of the GC Angle. Today I'm going to change it up a little bit and go for kind of inject a little bit more music theory into proceedings. So I'm going to look at a song called Close Your Eyes, and I'm going to look at the compositional devices I used, some of the technique, the performance directions I gave to the musicians, some music theory, and generally just how the song came to life in the studio. Right, so I'll play a simplified acoustic version of Close Your Eyes before I get stuck into the elements and facets behind the song.
Sometimes I feel so down, down, down. Close your eyes, close your eyes, close your eyes and drift them away. Sometimes I feel my heart hums deep dead. Sometimes I don't believe the words I'm saying. Close your eyes, close your eyes, close your eyes and drift them away, and drift them away, and drift them away.
Before every new recording project, I always draw up a to-do list, like a kind of a musical checklist. So that just lets me kind of reflect on, is there any kind of new techniques or new approaches that I want to weave into the new body of work? So for this album, I was keen on including a song that was no longer than 2.5 minutes in duration. So that kind of focused me to work within a duration, a framework, and remove any superfluous content from the track. I suppose the influence for that probably came from music of the 60s, and in particular the Beatles, because the Beatles, like, they're one of my favourite bands of all time, and they had this astute innate ability to create songs that were very short in duration but encompassed a lot musically. Like, even if you look at the Hard Day's Night LP, there's only one song on it, I believe, that reaches 2 minutes 43. And in fact, two of the songs on the album are actually under the 2 minute mark. So I just kind of wanted to set myself that task and that challenge and see how it would play out. Another task I set myself was to suggest musical complexity within something that's quite simple. So the whole song is based on two chords. There is an A minor and a B flat. So the whole song just goes between an A minor and a B flat. And that kind of creates this kind of an oscillating quality, because the root notes are a semitone apart. It's a minor second, so you're going. It's a bit like Jaws, actually. Okay, so a little bit of music theory. The score, the key signature in the score for the music is F major. So F major has one flat in it, B flat. So I'll just play the F major scale here. So in F major we have F, G, A, B flat, C, D, E, and F. However, this piece of music is not in the key of F, it's in fact modal. So this song is based on the A Phrygian mode. So basically I'm taking the notes of F major, but beginning it on the third degree of the scale. So for an F major, the third degree of the scale is an A. So I'll play all the notes of F, but I'm going to start on A here, and it's... So it's A, B flat, C, D, E, F, G, A. It's quite a dark and mysterious mode. And it's often associated with Iberian music, or it kind of has this ethnic flavor. It's a mode that doesn't really appear that much in popular music, although there is traces of it in the music of Metallica. And other examples I can give you are Set to Control for the Heart of the Sun by Pink Floyd. And also Jefferson Airplane, White Rabbit.
One pill makes you larger, and one pill makes you small.
And one more example of the Phrygian mode for you in popular music is Missy Elliott's Get Your Freak On. Okay, I just want to go back to the chord. So it's just an A minor going to a B flat. So it's just rolling back and forward, which, as you could imagine, could get pretty tedious and mundane fairly quickly. So I'll just play a very, very simplified version of how that would go.
Sometimes I feel so idealistic.
It works to some extent, however, it's just a little bit too generic and a little bit too obvious for my liking. Okay, so to break away from the song getting boring and repetitive and predictable, I use a kind of an interesting finger picking pattern. I also have guitar chords up the neck and I'm using my capo. So really the interest comes from what's going on my right hand. I'm using a finger picking pattern, which is my thumb, index and middle. In 4-4, this song is has a time signature of 4-4. There is 8 quaver beats in 4-4, so that's 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and. But instead, to create what's called syncopation, syncopation is an offbeat rhythm, I group my quavers differently. So I group them as 3 plus 3 plus 2. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. And at the original tempo. Also, to increase and heighten the musical intrigue and mysticism, I don't just use a simple A minor chord, I'm also working in the 7th and the 9th of that chord. So if I just played a regular A minor, it would be like this. But because I've worked in the 7th and the 9th, I get this more interesting, colorful feel. So structurally, the song is loosely based around sonata form. So sonata form has 3 components: the exposition, the development, and the recapitulation. In the exposition, the main musical content, the themes, the motifs, they're stated, they're presented to the listener. In the development section, these themes and musical ideas are expanded upon and further explored. And in the recapitulation, the opening material returns and creates a sense of finality, really. So let's look at the instrumentation and the personnel on the track now. You have myself, vocals, guitar, bass guitar, keyboard, glockenspiel, bouzouki, and prepared piano. Now you might be wondering what the hell prepared piano is, but I will explain that later on. So on the track, I also have Karima Dillon El-Toukhy on flute, Ella Englishby on cello, Sean Furey, saxophone, Dylan Curran, electric violin, Micheál Quinn, drums, and as the chamber choir, we have Rebecca Rodgers, Ciarán Brennan, and Niall Murray. So one of my objectives for this track was to suggest some kind of spiritual transcendence. One instrument that's quite interesting and helps evoke this kind of spiritual psychedelic feel is the bouzouki. So the bouzouki is associated with Greek music, but you can also find it in Irish music, and in particular two players that you should check out are Donal Lunny and Andy Irvine. Now, admittedly, I'm not much of a bouzouki player, but I'm decent at spoofing on instruments, so it's a cool sound. There's eight strings, it's in four sets of two, and sounds a bit like this. It's also pretty handy for playing backing chords. So I suppose it sounds a little bit, maybe when you play backing chords, it sounds a little bit like a 12-string guitar. However, naturally with a 12-string guitar, you're taking up a lot of notes, you're taking up a lot of space. So yeah, I quite like using this as a substitute for the 12-string guitar. I'll just show you a little example. Okay, so prepared piano. This is when you introduce a foreign object into the workings of the instrument. So for this song, I used blue tack. I attach blue tack to the strings of the piano, and then when the hammer hits those strings, it was creating a timbre and a tone similar to a marimba. I also held down the sustain pedal, and that kind of created this layering and a subtle dissonance. So I'll just show you how that sounds now. Okay, so let's look at some performance directions now. So for the cello, there is contrast between pizzicato and arco. The pizzicato is when the cellist uses their fingers, and arco is when they use the bow. During the development section, the music intensifies. So this is really the beginning of the trippy, hallucinogenic ascent. Here the full chamber choir have entered. There's arco in the cello. And we also have the saxophone by Sean Furey mixed with electric violin.
Oh, do you want to get scaldy with it?
The idea behind that was to create this continuous cacophonous drone. At this point we have polyphony as the fragmented melodies become interwoven and contrapuntal. The listener is implored to close their eyes and drift away before the recapitulation drags us back to reality. So if we look at the bass line, again, it's just two chords the whole way through, A minor and B flat. So the notes available to us in an A minor chord are A, C and E. And then in B flat we have B flat, D and F. A, C, E, A, E, C, A, C, E, E, A. On to an F, F, D, B flat, F, D, B flat, back to A. But also to create a little bit more interest, I used what's called pizzicato in the... So now pizzicato for the guitar is different to pizzicato in the violin and the cello. This is where we actually use palm muting. So this is where you take your strumming hand, put it across the bridge, and then use your tongue. And it creates this dampened, this kind of duller tone. So let's have a listen to the recording. You're going to hear the acoustic guitar and the bass now. Thank you. of interest worth mentioning, I think, is the use of word painting. So word painting is where the music reflects the words of the text. So the example I want to show you is the lyric Down, 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 which is in verse 1. The vocal melody also moves down, so that kind of increases that effect. It goes like this.
Sometimes I feel so idealistic. Sometimes I feel so down, down, down.
I also have it in verse 2, when it goes, sometimes I feel my heart is beating. So to suggest an accelerated heart rate and heartbeat, I use this.
Sometimes I feel my heart is beating.
So just play kind of a tremolo.
Sometimes I feel my heart is beating.
So yeah, that's a bit of word painting for you. Other angles in regards to instrumentation includes the use of the shruti box. So the shruti box is an Indian instrument. It's quite similar to a harmonium, but the two notes that we use is an A and a B flat, and that makes sense because they're the root of the two chords. You'll hear this gong sound at the start of the song. Let's just have a listen to that now. It's not a gong. How we came about it was quite serendipitous. So Ian Flynn, the co-producer and engineer, was in the Jacks in Sun Studio, and his belt hit off the sink, and it just created this wonderful, sustained pitch. And he was like, yeah, Greg, we've got to track this. We've got to put it on the album somewhere. So I went in, hit my belt off it a few times, and then Ian pitch shifted it to A and to B flat, and it just fit in very naturally into this song, because again, we have this ethnic flavor, this musical intrigue and mysticism. Right, thanks so much for checking out this video. I hope you found it enjoyable, entertaining, and educational. If you wish to contribute to these podcasts, you can do so at this link. And also, if you dig my tunes, my EP is available exclusively on Bandcamp. So there's 2 songs for free, and if you wish to unlock the other 4, you just gotta pay the gesture fee of a fiver. Cool, thanks so much. So let's have a listen to the entire recorded version of Close Your Eyes. Catch you soon.
Sometimes I feel so idealistic. Sometimes I feel so down, down, down. Close your eyes. Sometimes I don't believe the words I'm saying. Close your eyes.